It's also important to consider how moderns human vary. This can help us better understand human evolution and how we came to be. So let's go over what we know about the differences between modern humans. So you might have noticed there's a lot of different humans out there, and there's a variety of different ways we look. I'm lucky to be in New York City, one of the most metropolitan cities in the world, so I get to see a lot of different people on a fairly regular basis. And there is a many different ways that we vary. So there's different skin colors, different body parts portions, there's blood types, respiration, or different adaptations to respiration, and different diets. Unfortunately, skin color does have a lot of negative connotations associated, and we do need to move past all of these racist ideals, but we can't ignore the fact that variation does exist. It's important to understand how what it means, though, and the fact that it doesn't mean race. If you need to, go back and rewatch some of those lectures. One of the things we see in modern humans a lot is something called a cline. And this is just a fancy word that means a continuum or a gradient. And we see these all over the place. So here's just one of the loci in the HLA axis, or one of our immune system genes. And you can see there's just a gradient of the frequencies which we see this. Obviously, this study didn't sample everywhere because the world's pretty big. It's hard to get hard to sample every single population when you're looking at a gene. But you can see the allele frequencies are high in some places and gradually get lower in others. Of course, the most famous cline that we see is our skin color. So we see d the darkest skin colors at in the middle of the world, and lighter skin colors the farther away you get from the equator. But really, this is just related to the amount of UV radiation. Skin color is one of the best examples of an adaptation in humans. So really, we should be teaching this explicitly as a way to better understand race, but also a way to understand adaptations and what they are. So skin color, it's protection against UV radiation. Because remember, UV radiation destroys folate. So if you live in a place with a lot of UV radiation, you need that dark skin to protect you, so you don't destroy that folate. But on the other hand, we also need a little bit of UV radiation to synthesize vitamin D. So we have these two opposing pressures, and that's why you in different places, there's a different optimal balance to find the best of both of these worlds. But we also have a lot else we can say about modern human genetic variation. Overall, there is just low genetic diversity amongst all humans. This indicates that we're just young, or there's a fairly recent population expansion. And remember, the earliest individuals of our species are about 300,000 years old. Interestingly enough, most genetic variation in humans is actually found in every single population. There are, of course, some unique adaptations in specific places, but these are generally related to like very specific things, so such as hypoxia or lactose tolerance. Let's remind ourselves of some of these graphics. So here we can see that all modern humans cluster really close together, and we see just bigger spreads in the genetic diversity of orangutans, gorillas, and chimpanzees. So even though there are more of us, we just haven't had enough time to accumulate that much diversity. And here with these Venn diagrams, you can see that most genetic variation in all humans is actually shared amongst all populations. And there's a small sliver of some genetic variation that is unique to some populations, such as Europeans, but really most of the diversity we find in Africans. And if you want to zoom in, so here is a really cool analysis done on modern European populations, and you can see there's just a lot of overlap between these different populations. So even though we can find these differences, most of our differences are cultural, and not reflected in our biology. There's some other things we can say as well. So there is a gradual reduction in genetic diversity with increasing distance from East Africa. And also, when we look at the phylogeny, all non-African lineages nest within those African lineages. So we can represent this graphically so you can see there's just more differences in Africa, more different variants. And there some of them got out of Africa, but by and large, there's just not as much variation in other populations outside of Africa. Here's some more comprehensive data. So you can see the farther two populations are apart, there is a greater genetic distance between them. So that's fairly common sense, but that shows that populations tend to interbreed with neighboring populations. And then this bottom graph here, there's just this gradual reduction in genetic diversity the farther you get from East Africa. Of course, it's not that much, and it's certainly not, you know, it doesn't impair anyone in this way, but it does indicate that there is this serial founder event that happened as our ancestors were migrating out of Africa. And here we can look at the phylogeny comparing African to non-African lineages, and we can see all non-African lineages are fairly young and cluster very close together. So this indicates a relatively recent expansion out of Africa, and we see these deeper or more basal lineages still residing within Africa. So can you explain? How do modern humans vary?